Test the recording button, so technically we are starting, but then we just think. But anyway, welcome, ladies and gentlemen. This is episode 8 of the Include or Xclude podcast. Today, my guest to my right of me, actually to my left of me, sorry, fellow DJ, big drum bass head, probably the only drum bass head I know. I want to get to know about that drummer through this person to my left of me, ladies and gentlemen, Marble, aka Taylor. What's it? How do you pronounce your last name?
Potiker.
Potiker. Yeah. Taylor Potiker, ladies and gentlemen. I always try to make a mention of that and get the last name right, just to make sure that everything's all set and ready to go. But anyway, Taylor, where did you grow up, man?
I grew up in Reading, Pennsylvania. So that's like maybe an hour and 20 minutes out of the city. So it's like sort of halfway between like Reading City and Lancaster. So like I grew up in like out in the boonies, you know, where all the cornfields are and stuff like that.
Gotcha. Did you first really, like, what made you eventually become a DJ? And or what were you like musical influences growing up?
Well, music was always a big thing to me. I mean, I grew up listening to like Van Halen and Queen and Def Leppard and stuff with my parents. And I always had a knack for remembering lyrics and recognizing tones and stuff like that. And I played a bunch of different instruments when I was younger. None of them actually stuck. Mm-hmm. So like I played violin, I played trumpet.
I played trombone at one point. It didn't stick this as well.
I had a guitar for a little while and started messing around with that. And it was just a bunch of experimenting between different instruments, what I liked and whatnot. And strangely enough, I was really big into metal and grunge right before I got into electronic stuff. Now, I'd always liked like dead mouse like that's where my roots were,
was gotcha.
Dead mouse, you know, like way back in the day, like hearing strobe, stuff like that. And then I ended up getting into I remember when Skrillex came out with the Scary Monsters and Nice Sprites, like I used to love that kind of stuff, but it was very niche, you know. I was still super big into metal. And then
but yeah, what year was that, if you had to recall?
Oh geez. Honestly, I really only got super involved in the electronic scene maybe about 5 or 6 years ago.
Gotcha.
So when I got involved with that, it started with like the typical stuff, like Big Room.
You know, yeah, like Calvin Harris and stuff like that.
Yeah. I started like my whole dive into the rave scene going to Soundgarden. That's where my whole thing started. I know like a lot of people, older guys, like they had like Shampoo and stuff like that. But like Soundgarden was my place. That's where I started.
Dude, I never went to Soundgarden. I've always heard about it. And how was that place?
Oh, dude, it was awesome. It's different because like I'd been to other clubs before. It was just one giant big room, you know. But Soundgarden was different. It was like long. It was like a long hallway sort of. And in the center, you had these huge 6 pillars that when it was packed out, people used to stand up on them. And it was like, I don't know. It was magical. You know, I like that place because that's where I got my roots from. I went and saw like Adventure Club there. I saw, there's so many. I went to so many. I was there like almost every weekend for like, you know, a year straight.
Where I grew up, where I still reside at this day, Newark, Delaware, a lot of the kids from University of Delaware, they would take party buses. Mm-hmm. And I'm not quite sure how that party bus thing works, but I know it's a thing in Delaware. It's like where, I don't know, I guess they make an event on Facebook and everybody who is a student somehow gets to know about it. And they would always go to Soundgarden. Mm-hmm. And from what I heard, the place that I heard is pretty damn cool just as well. Adventure Club, I remember, I wasn't there, but I definitely want to see them. I definitely wanted to see them. They were, I think at the time I was working at Toyota, and most of the new cars came equipped with Sirius, mm-hmm. Sirius XM, and I always listened to Channel 51, you know, BPM.
Yep.
And yeah. I think Adventure Club, I think one day had a mixtape or did a live show. And We had that was a blast. I always wanted to see them live. At least from what I heard, they were very cool. Just the way how they kind of performed and kind of carried themselves.
Yeah.
Let's see here. Yeah, Soundgarden was cool.
I mean, it was. I loved going there because they had a great variety of different kinds of music. So like. Like one night they would have trance, the next they would have bass house, the next they would have dubstep. And this is back like before dubstep got into the whole rhythm thing, which is where it got a little too heavy. I hate rhythm. I can't stand it. You know, I end up renting CDJs to rhythm collectives all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And they beat the shit out of your mixer. And they're cool people, but yep. That kind of music is a little too heavy for me. But this was like the golden age of like EDM in Philadelphia for me. That's when like there was a good variety of everything back when dubstep was still super melodic and whatnot. Like mm-hmm. Adventure Club, like
right.
They were amazing. When mm-hmm. I first saw them, like it was probably one of the most memorable shows I've been to. Not just because of the music, but because of the amount of money I spent on the tickets.
Gotcha. Now, I'm noticing here in the state, well, just to set the scene before I go into my next question, it is pouring outside. It is thundering, it is lightning, so if the power still happens to go out, just sorry in advance, but it's a kind of a dark, stormy night, as if we're on like a ship in the middle of the ocean. All I'm missing is like the boat rocking back and forth, and we're in that kind of vibe. We're like nearby the galley, we're nearby the kitchen. Inside a small little living room, but it's cozy, you know, dim lights and stuff like that. But anyway, going into my next question, I'm noticing on the table that there you have an Ultra lanyard, or somebody in the house does. Have you been to Ultra?
Yes. Ultra was...
Just recently, the one that just passed?
No. This is maybe like 3 or 4 years ago. So like Ultra was like my beginning stint into festivals. So like, it actually ties in with the Adventure Club show that I had went to.
Okay.
So, like, I had my friend Shane that was big into EDM at the time, and he wanted me to go with him down to Florida to go to Ultra. And I said, all right, you know, sure. I didn't really have the money for it. So I ended up going out and taking out a personal loan for, like, $3,000. I spent, like, $1,000 of that on the airfare, where I was staying, and the ticket to Ultra itself. And then... like, I think it was like the Friday before I left for Ultra. Like, I think I left that Monday. That Friday, right before we left, Adventure Club was having a show at Soundgarden, and it was sold out. So I was like, you know what? Fuck it. You know, I really want to go to this. I just got like, I got $2,000, you know? So I went and spent like $120 a ticket for 2 tickets to this show. And even though it was a bunch of money, you know, the mm-hmm. experience was worth it. You know, and after that, like, I went to Ultra, and it was probably, like, one of the most amazing experiences I've ever had in my life. It was my first time traveling somewhere by myself. I mean, my friends were down there, but I got on a plane by myself and did all that alone. But
I remember that, too. I take that back. I remember seeing Ultra, first off on YouTube when Eric Prydz was performing.
Oh, yeah, dude, I actually saw him.
Really, yeah. His live shows are like what because of the lighting. It's like very like it's surreal, but it's like in your face.
Yeah,
like I've always seen the clips and stuff like that.
Yeah, I love their trance stage because like it was like this huge. It looked like an aircraft hangar.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. And then up above you, they had like these honeycombs. They're like LCD screens.
And lowers down.
That could lower down mm-hmm. and like shift and change and like it was an experience. That's for sure. And main stage was amazing too. Like they had like water fountains that had fire coming out of the top of them, and it was just like I'm not big into like that big room jump up and down kind
of
stuff.
But
anymore,
that's like the embodiment.
Oh my god!
Yeah,
the energy you feel being in a crowd of like 10,000 people all jumping up and down at the same time. Mm-hmm. Like it's that feeling, that energy that you get from that. You know, it's mm-hmm. it's become this huge like. How do I explain it? It's become the mainstream, really. You know, you see a lot of bros and a lot of like super hot chicks dressed up in like barely anything. You know, that's become like the modern rave scene. You know, and even though that has its downsides, and rave culture used to be a place for misfits. You know, it was still cool to feel that inclusiveness, no matter what you were, or what you looked like, or anything. You know,
I agree. Now, I'm not, granted, I'm not so much of a festival person, more like a club kind of guy. But again, alluding to what you said earlier, it's the embodiment, I feel, at least for Ultra. It's the kind of like the embodiment of like a big room kind of sound. And what I'm hearing from this year, at least, is that the people that have been to Ultra before and have been to the main stages and, you know, the big rooms or whatever, they're going more to like the more like the smaller, kind of, well, I don't want to say smaller, but the lesser known kind of genres. I'm guessing drum and bass and or techno and or, you know, melodic techno and or, you know, all these other, all these other genres, like they're like they've heard EDM before. It's like they're getting progressive, tiring with that. And now you're hearing kind of, well, at least you're seeing more, more and more crowds going to the other stages and kind of exploring, electronic music in general. Now, alluding back even more to what you said earlier, yes, I was into metal just as well. Like more like new metal, like Korn and Limp Bizkit.
Oh yeah,
and that was my thing.
Yep.
And then I transitioned from that to hip hop, you know, more like Method Man, listening to Nas and Cassie, and always like I'm a Hustler remixes and like all those like 1,000 remixes that they made of that track.
I'm like I'm a huge fan of old school hip hop, and I like a lot of the underground stuff. I'm a big fan of like Immortal Technique and Jedi Mind Tricks. I'm trying to think of some other good ones. I always love Biggie too.
Gotcha. I was see the whole I talked to this with Hesh, and like he was like into the Biggie, Tupac kind of thing. I was like kind of like outside of that. Like I felt like because I was born in like 1990, so I was kind of like on the like I was born just when like all that stuff was like escalating, so I wasn't really like paying attention to it. But I did pay attention to Nas because he was like. Like I feel like among that same time, but sounded kind of like separate. Like he was from Queens. I'm not sure where Biggie and Tupac from, but I know they're from New York, of course. But I felt they were maybe in the Bronx or in Harlem. I'm not quite sure. But regardless, they were of that same era and they lived kind of nearby. So that's whom I listened to, and that's who I put in high regard just as well. Now, granted, most people like Tupac and Biggie, and that's perfectly fine. They hold nothing against them, but I just wasn't born at that time, and that's perfectly fine.
Yeah, I mean, rap music has always been interesting to me. I mean, I've always sort of liked the older sort of rap compared to like the newer kind of stuff because they talked about real problems.
Agreed.
Like they talked about actual controversy. Real shit. Real shit. Yeah, exactly. And like that was the biggest thing for me because it I didn't exactly grow up in an impoverished community, but you felt the passion, you knew like what they were going through when you look
right,
at
the everyday struggles.
Yes. Yeah. And then you look at like modern rap music and it's all about, you know, drugs and money and they mumble into a microphone. I feel like recently culture has been taking a turn for the worse and a lot of it's been dying. Like all modern pop songs sound the same and rap is all mumbling. And
I understand. My only kind of exception to that was, I am a fan of ASAP Mob, ASAP Rocky,
and he's a cool guy,
ASAP 20, and everybody else. I am a fan of that, but that's kind of like the only genre. That's kind of like the only newer kind of rap group that I kind of listen to every once in a while. Then Action Bronson, I think he's just a cool dude. I still watch a show on Vice. I'm trying to think of the name. I'm gonna sound like an idiot, but I'll just post edit this. He's like in Brooklyn, just like looking at these restaurants or even overseas with the boys, and just like because he was a chef at one point, and he's like surveying the scene while he's doing concerts and like going out to all these restaurants and kind of exploring the food and the culture there. I think that's kind of cool, and I feel that also with music, it's like whenever you travel, let's say you get a guidebook like Rick Steves or whatever, you go flip through it at Barnes and Noble. You know, they have places of interest. They have food, how to get there, you know, maybe probably a built-in map inside the book, how to get there.
You should never, ever listen to those books.
I do reference them every once in a while. If I feel like, if I'm like totally lost, I'll be like, okay, where should I maybe go? Because I feel like I'm a tourist and I kind of want to go with that vibe a little bit. But I do throw in my own little flavor. With Resident Advisor and how they document everything, which is cool.
Resident Advisor is definitely really cool, but I've been to Europe recently. I went to Italy, and when my girlfriend and I actually went, we didn't really have an itinerary. We didn't really have any specific plans except for like a handful of things. Like I wanted to see the Colosseum when we were in Rome. I wanted to see Pompeii when we were in Naples. And we wanted to see the Amalfi Coast.
How long were you there for?
2 weeks.
Oh, wow.
2 weeks. Nice. Yeah. It was honestly the best 2 weeks of my life. I had a lot of amazing bonding time with my girlfriend. I always thought like my first big dub was when I fell in love with her. But I honestly think Italy was probably like that big thing for us. You know, I bonded a lot with her. I had the time of my life, really. And when we went, like, we didn't have a specific plan, like I said. And we intentionally got lost. And we took a lot of interesting, we talked to people we met there and asked them where we should go. Instead of, like, going on Resident Advisor, we wanted to intentionally...
I like that idea.
Yeah, we intentionally didn't want to do the touristy thing. You know, we could have been like my parents when they went, like, 20 years ago and get on a tour bus with, like, you know... 24 other like Americans, you know,
right.
With their socks.
Look at this, look at that. Oh, yeah. Wow. Let me go
cameras,
to where's the gift shop?
You know, living through their camera lens instead of like actually being there. And like the idea was that we wanted to immerse ourselves in the culture a little bit. So like we didn't do your typical Italy trip. Like we didn't go to Venice or Milan or Florence. We started down south, down in the countryside. And my girlfriend actually used to work for this couple that owned a pizza shop back in Reading. And they have a house over there. So, like, their first 2 or 3 days, we got to stay there at this bed and breakfast. And I believe their family owns an olive plantation. So, like, first thing I noticed when we got down there is, like, there's olive trees as far as you can see. And it's all hilly and stuff. Like, it's like, mountainous.
Where was this at? Tuscany, give or take?
No, the Tuscany's a little further north. This was Calabria.
Okay.
So, like, it's down, like, you know how Italy's in the shape of a boot?
Yes.
Calabria is, like, the bottom half of it. We were,
gotcha.
Like, in the arch of the boot.
Gotcha. Not quite Sicily, but just a
yes.
little bit farther up.
Yeah. Sicily, okay. Apparently, according to Italians, is a completely different place.
Hmm.
You know, like, the dialect they speak is different. And something I thought was interesting. Like, we learned a little bit of Italian before we went.
Okay.
And, like, we met some friends in Rome and we talked about this. And, like, if you were to go all the way down south and speak Italian and you were from the north,
mm-hmm.
you'd have a tough time understanding people because they have a dialect, you know? So,
right.
like...
It's like almost like us Spanish people going like to Spain.
It's like a slang.
Yeah, it's a slang. Yeah.
yeah. Yeah. So if you learn like typical Spanish from Spain and then you learn like Spanish from Mexico, it's different.
Right.
You know, so like you get the gist of what they're saying,
mm-hmm.
but you know, there's a little bit of slang in there.
Right. I understand. But going back to what I was alluding to earlier, with travel, you know, you see all this stuff in like a travel book, let's say for example, on a bus, or whatever,
mm-hmm.
but they don't really kind of explore music. That's very kind of like,
yeah,
it's hit and miss. And us being electronic music guys, it's kind of like, okay, where do I go?
And well, see, that was my big problem when we were there. Now I know, my girlfriend and I plan on trying to go back again sometime soon because there's a drum and bass festival on the island of Sardinia for like a week every year. It's called Sun and Bass. And like I know it's not like some of the heavier stuff that, you know, I'm into, but like it's
regardless, but no, regardless.
Oh, yeah. I just want to spend a fucking summer on an Italian beach listening to drum and bass. I think it would be the most incredible thing ever. And it's an expensive trip, and like I'm dying to go back. I really am. But
well, with Sardinia, from what I heard, or at least from what I heard with Tuscany, the food is like kind of, it's not so expensive.
Oh, down south? Oh,
yeah.
My God. Oh, yeah. It is so cheap. We could get a bottle of fresh local wine for like €5. And that's like, I don't know. It's like
$5-7.
Yeah, it's
give
like
or take.
$5 or $6,
right.
Something like that. Because I think the conversion rate's like $1.20 for €1.
Yeah, just about. And when I went over to, now granted, this is more expensive. When I went over to London,
mm-hmm.
the Brexit was just happened.
Okay.
Not too long ago. And they were using the pound.
Yeah.
And I was looking at the exchange rate. Man, this is a pricey fucking city.
London is ridiculous.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. But that's how with where I found drum bass.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, that's where it came from. I mean,
yep.
It has its roots in raga, you know, so
mm-hmm.
like a lot of that's from Jamaica.
Yep.
But, you know, it took off, especially with jungle in the UK.
Yes.
So, like that, I don't know. It's so funny. Like,
and I feel also with Acid House, if you go more
yeah.
northern towards England,
yeah.
Like Nottingham, like where, I forget where that record store is at, but it's I gotta put that in a post edit. It's like this one place in Northern London where they had like recognized for that sound, like kind of like drum bass and or acid house, that kind of sound. It kind of like it made its way, it made its rounds through London, I feel, and kind of made itself more popular and more recognizable. Now it's a worldwide platform, worldwide genre.
Yeah.
But I found drum and bass when I was, I went over to Fabric and never hearing drum and bass before ever. I'm like, this is fucking awesome. I got, and I was like meeting all the strangers, and they give me like, you know, this nice warm welcome. And even though like I need to get more into drum and bass, whenever I hear it, I'm taken back by that feeling. Like I feel like almost like a community kind of like it welcomes you with open arms, and I respect that, and they respect me. So it's like I'm gonna keep that like energy going throughout the night and just see where it takes me and get lost in that respect.
Yeah. And that's the great thing about it. And if you were to ever go to a festival or an event where they were playing drum and bass, like I always remember this DJK podcast where he was talking. He had some guy talking about like what drum and bass does to people. And it's like how fast it is, how the intricacy of the drums. It's hard not to dance to it, even if you're just bobbing up and down. You know, like if you go to a place and they're blaring neurofunk and everyone's losing their shit, it's hard. It's contagious. You know, it's hard not to get involved with that. Where you look at like house and whatnot, it's more of like a chill thing.
Yeah.
You know, you're sitting there bobbing your head, but drum and bass, like,
it's right there.
It gets you. You know, like it just pulls you in, you know, and that's the thing I always thought was fascinating about it. I love the speed of it too. Yeah. You know, I've struggled with ADHD most of my life.
Okay.
And so like my attention span's kind of short when it comes to certain things and I like to move fast. So like
keeps you in that rhythm.
Yeah. Yeah. It helps control that, you know?
Yeah. Like, oh, okay.
That's why I love DJing too. It's all timing and phrasing. It allows me to hyper focus, you know?
Now, why did you DJ in the first place? You couldn't become anything. Why DJ?
I don't know. Cause when I got sucked into the whole rave scene, I was excited by it. I thought it was fascinating, you know, and I ended up meeting some friends who were producers, and I had a couple friends that were DJs as well. So, I don't know. I found a fascination with it, and I found my way in through like controllers and stuff like that. And I don't know. I started with like the typical stuff, like I started talking about, like house and bass house, that kind of stuff. And then when I evolved into more of a drum and bass fan, that's when it really took off for me. I got a lot more in depth in it because I found the complexity of it, you know, a little more interesting, you know, because I could mix house with one hand behind my back, you know, that like 128 BPM, it's so easy to beat match that kind of stuff. You can tell if you're off even a little bit just through your headphones, you know, but when it comes to drum and bass, it's a little more difficult, especially jungle, because the snares are all over the place. And like, if you don't have good track knowledge, you can't just mash two tracks together. So like, you got to know where all the breaks are. You have to know like when and where the drum patterns change. Otherwise it sounds horrible. So like it's a tremendous fear of train wrecking with drum and bass, because you know, if you didn't have sufficient practice beforehand, if you don't have track knowledge, it gets kind of tough. Where like say house music, I think, is a little easier to control, and it's more of a vibey kind of thing to spin. You know, it's fun. I love spinning house music just because it's simplistic, it's fun,
right? You know? You almost like let the track breathe.
Yes. Yeah. Where like drum and bass is, you're a little more focused in on it.
Right.
Now I think, you know, if I do this for years, I think I'm going to sort of get to that point that I did with house where it's like, you know, second nature.
Yeah.
But you know, the complexity of it is what I love the most, really.
Now, how did you come up with the name Marble? Did you lose your marbles at one point?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So it was kind of okay. Yeah. I figured that was like, okay, on the right track.
Yeah, that's actually exactly how it happened. Yeah. It's a little bit of an illicit story, but, you know, that's basically the terms of it, how it happened.
Gotcha. Now, going back to drum bass, have you ever DJed with like an MC?
No, I haven't.
I feel that's like an integral kind of like part of like playing live and putting it out there. Like,
yes.
How is that relationship like with drum and bass?
Oh, it's amazing. UK, like, MCs are incredible. They're amazing rappers. They really are. Compared to like American rapping, like the direction that's going with the mumbling and whatnot, I find UK MCs are like that's stayed kind of, you know, it's a little hard to understand sometimes, you know, because it's fast.
Right.
But like, I just love UK MCs. I would kill for the opportunity to play along with someone. I played with percussion artists before, mm-hmm. which is always really interesting, you know, because drum and bass is all drum right. and bass, you know. So, like, it's nice to play along with percussion artists because they have freedom to do whatever. Mm-hmm. It's always a neat sound. But, yeah, I've always been fascinated with trying to mix, like, or get, like, American rap artists involved with what I'm trying to do. Because I think, you know, there's a huge divide, like, when it comes to music nowadays. Because, like, I think, especially in Philadelphia, there's a divide between, you know, like, African-American culture, rap culture, and then, like, you know, a lot of white people go to EDM shows. So I'm fascinated with the idea of trying to build a bridge between the cultures and get, like, both sides involved with each other. Mm-hmm. And I think a good way to do that is to involve rap. Mm-hmm. Because, like, right now, like, the EDM scene in Philadelphia is mostly rhythm, you know, and mm-hmm. there's techno and house. But drum and bass is a big thing back in the day. You know?
Yeah, oh, yeah, that was the thing.
You had Concrete Jungle and all of that. So that was a huge influence. But then, you know, these old head ravers, they got older and they all moved out to, like, D.C. and New York City, you know, because the drum and bass community in D.C. and New York is still huge.
Yes.
You know, compared to Philadelphia, which has sort of lost its touch with drum and bass, right. which is why I feel like a fish out of water here sometimes, you know. But I like the whole idea behind what I'm doing, like my collective and everything, is I want to try and create a resurgence. Because I know like these kids that are into rhythm and stuff like that, and that's going to grow old eventually, mm-hmm. you know. And like that scene, especially nowadays, is fueled a lot by illicit things like drugs and whatnot. And I want to try to create something different, you know, a place where people can enjoy music. I want to take us back to the roots of what the whole rave thing was, plur, peace, love, unity, and respect. So I want to take it back to the, like, what that was. You know, I don't care if people have fun and do drugs and drink and whatnot, but, you know, like, the content of, like, whatever you're doing needs to change. And I want to try and lead, like, a renaissance, really. You know, I want to mm-hmm. change the way electronic music is viewed. You know, I want it to be a cool place for everybody of all different creeds and cultures to come together and just experience and love music.
Yeah, I agree just as well. It's like almost like stripping it down to what it was.
Yeah.
Again, peace, love, unity, respect. And it's like bringing that energy out there
yeah.
for people who may not heard drum and bass and or even rhythm or even house or jungle or whatever. Just having that kind of like culmination, everybody. Almost like when you go to the Barbie, let's say. There's always, if you've never been to the Barbie, it's a small little.
Oh, I've been there.
I have too, trust me. And, you know, there's two floors and everything else, but, you know, whoever's playing upstairs and whoever's playing downstairs, that crowd kind of like intermingles with each other and they go yep. back and forth in between floors. Mm-hmm. And with that, you know, you hear that kind of, you feel and hear that energy with people who may have not experienced each other's genre, mm-hmm. no matter what it's
yeah.
playing. And you know, it's kind of like you're exploring yourself as well as exploring that music. And if we can have more of that kind of culmination, I feel like this city's going to go that much more diverse.
Well, so, like, the one thing I've noticed is, like, after coming to the city, you know, to go to shows and whatnot for the longest time, I noticed that a lot of these shows were starting to lean more towards single genre. And that was
yeah.
the biggest thing for me, because I didn't like going to a show and hearing mm-hmm. just dubstep all night.
Yep.
It got old. I got bored with it. You know, there wasn't any variety with it, you know. So, like, when we throw shows, we try to have a little bit of fucking everything, you know. So, like you usually try to put the faster stuff towards the end of the night, like drum and bass. I try to close out when I can, you know.
Right.
Not the headliner, but the closer.
Well, well, you did good at Sprout Collective.
Oh, thank you for that.
Yeah, I was there.
I appreciate that, man, really. Yeah, because like the first guy we had was like funk, and then the next guy was like trap, And then we had bass house and then drum and bass. And I just love the different kinds of variety. I feel like it keeps people entertained because they don't know.
Keeps it coming back.
Yeah. Yeah. They don't know what's coming up next.
Right. And also like with that crowd, you know, the bar profits just as well. And everybody's entertained and that much more people come by. Almost like to what Shampoo, I guess, was. Like, granted, I came into Shampoo when they were playing hip-hop. Mm-hmm. But not so much when they were playing house. But when I was there, they had a little bit of everything. Mm-hmm. You know, with the three rooms and everything else just as well. Did you ever go to Shampoo?
I never was there.
For me, that was like, for me, just getting into, like, the Philly kind of clubs. And it was, like, going to Shampoo. Yeah. And then from there... but going to out to the neighborhood, that's where I got my start as well, because yeah. I was finding myself and finding like my sexuality, and just explain like going to Eye Candy, going to Boyer, and going to Woody's, and they were all like super close to each other. Mm. So like it's basically like on Fridays or Saturdays, or even on Mondays. Well, not so much Mondays. Monday it was just Eye Candy, but on the weekends, sometimes it would be I would always go first to Eye Candy, just the warm things of like let's say 9 o'clock. Mm. And then if I was like kind of like, okay, let's go a little further, you know, I would go to Woody's and party till 2. If I was really, really feeling it, I'd do all three. Mm-hmm. I'd go to Eye Candy, I'd go to Woody's, I'd go to Voyeur. And Voyeur, of course, is more like the after-hours club. Mm-hmm. And it's not, you don't see that much, I think, too much anymore. It's like Trilogies, that's one after-hours club, and then the Shampoo. Yeah. And now, granted, you do have like more kind of like outlaw party / you know, I guess that more techno parties that go on till like, I don't know, till 5 or 5 or more. Mm-hmm. But you don't really see too much of like the after hour scene too much anymore.
Yeah.
Which is kind of sad, but it's like understandable. Yeah. At that same time, because I guess at that time, like, you know, it gets kind of wild. You know, security, I guess, has a hard time. I'm not sure if the bar is going to profit just as much as everybody else has already had X amount to drink and or has done something. I don't know, dumb sign under some blow or under some ass or whatever. And it's kind of like hard to like wrangle people.
Yeah, after like 3 a.m., that's when people start to get crazy.
Yeah, and you know, you see these ads all the time for these after hours parties. It's like, oh, we'll go to 6, we'll go to 5. And like, that's great, but it's like
I'm getting too old for that.
Yeah, it's like, I'm getting too old for that. And it's like the majority of people like can only last till like 4.
Yeah.
You know, it's only when and if like you wake up and it's like 1 a.m. Then you go to the party. Then you can make it the whole way through. But if you're going like back to back to back, it's like that's a bit tough. That's a high call. But why? Next question. Why make Cerberus though? How did that come across?
Well, I was part of a collective before, and it was an okay project. You know, I had some disagreements with the guy that was running it. But you know, I kind of wanted something for myself, something, you know, that I could, you know, be at the forefront of. So, actually the name Curvis, actually, it's funny how we actually got that. I always been fascinated with like, Roman history.
Okay.
And like, antiquity and whatnot. So I wanted something in Latin. So like, I was looking for something that was like cool, different, you know, like, and I settled on Curvus because in Latin, or Cervus, which actually means stag in Latin. So we actually came from an area where, yeah, we were seeing deer all the time, you know, like we came from the countryside.
I understand.
So like the whole idea, like I told you, I feel like a fish out of water here in Philadelphia. Like our whole thing when we started is like, have you ever seen a stag in the city? You know, it's different. It's not something you see. It's a rarity.
Right.
You know, and if you do see it, it's like, wow, look at that. You know, like grabs your attention. And that was the whole idea behind it. We wanted to be that rarity. We wanted to be something that grabbed your attention, something you didn't see every day. So like that was the whole like thing behind it.
I do like the name, and I do like the logo just as well.
It's fucking awesome. Actually, I have to say the logo was actually done by a friend I met when I was in Italy. Some chick named Ricky from the UK. I hit her
shout
up.
Shout out.
Shout out, Ricky. she did it for free and everything. I was just like, hey, she said she was an artist. Uh-huh. And I was like, well, I gave her an idea of what I wanted. Right. She made it completely unique to us. You know, she didn't take an, we gave her some ideas of what right. we wanted, but then she made it unique. And like now I'm so proud of it. It, we put it on t-shirts. We got it on those awesome business cards. Like I want to put it on everything, you know, I'm just so fascinated by it. It's, she did such an amazing job.
I like the idea. Just, I like the idea. I like the concept. I think it's, I just keep sticking with it. I was talking with Cody like for names actually. And I was like, yo, service. However you pronounce it, sorry if I'm butchering it.
That's okay.
But regardless, I was like, yo, go with that. I feel like the country is not like it's not represented so much in German. It's drum and bass or jungle or whatever in electronic music. So it's like having that image, I feel really strikes.
It's different.
It's different. Yeah, it's different.
It stands out, and that's why I liked it so much. You know, the big problem we faced when we were trying to come up with the name is we were a little concerned, like, it might make us look like rednecks.
Yeah, like stereotypical kind of shit, dumb stuff.
Yeah, you know, because especially the way with, you know, I don't want to call it PC culture, but like...
Conservative.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm just concerned people might attribute that to, like, hunting.
I understand. I get you.
And you know how people are with this vegan movement.
Right.
They hate that kind of stuff, you know. So there was a lot of concerns going forward, but I stayed, you know, firm. Like, this is what I want, and I think it's going to be awesome. And despite, like, people having their doubts, it ended up being amazing. I'm so happy where it's at right now.
Speaking of things you don't see every day, you actually own a rabbit.
Yeah.
Explain that. Why was like the reasoning for that? What's his name? What's her name?
His name is Pongo.
And shout out Pongo.
Shout out Pongo. He, I actually, back in Reading, I used to work for this job called Delivery Dudes, just like Grubhub.
Gotcha.
And one day they found this rabbit running around in the parking lot, and I came back and they didn't have a home for him. They were looking for somebody to take him in. And I was like, oh my God, my girlfriend will love this. But, you know, now that I think about it, you know, in the future is like, it was like a responsibility that I'm just like, hey, babe, look at this.
I got you. You. Yeah, I got you. I got you. I've always, I remember when I saw Pongo, I'm like, I've always thought I don't have any tattoos. Like, granted, you do. I'll mention that. That'll be my next question. I'm a big fan of Enter the Matrix.
Oh, yeah?
And whenever I see that, like, a rabbit, I've always thought about getting a rabbit tattoo.
Down the
rabbit hole. Because, like, I've had so many, like, passion pits.
Yeah.
That, like, I'm, like, you know, I'm into cycling. I'm into DJing.
Oh, yeah.
Cars. I was into skiing, scooters, BMX.
I snowboard, actually. You still skiing?
I just don't know how to ski. I still got my boots, but not my skis. But I can always go to the rental shop and be like, hey, let me grab a set.
Yeah, I try to do an annual trip to Vermont every year with a bunch of friends. And the more people we get, the nicer place we can get.
Okay.
Like, last year, the place we went was really nice. It was like a three-bedroom place.
Mm-hmm.
But there were some really nice ones. There was one that had like six bedrooms. It had like a wall of windows, like a cabin.
It was like a cabin.
Yeah,
kind of sort of.
It was like a cabin in the middle of the woods. All like, and it was all glass. You could see out over like. And when we went up there, it was like already 2 feet of snow, and it snowed the whole weekend we were there. There was this massive snowstorm, and you should come with us. We're always looking for more people to go with.
Gotcha. Now I got. Now for me, if I'm going to Vermont, it's going to be like strictly like. Blue trail, green trail, because you know it's a little bit different up there.
It's a little tougher sometimes, but I think like especially the place we went this year, Killington, it's got a lot of
that's what
long
boy went to last year.
They have tunnels. Like you like end
tunnels.
Up skiing through a tunnel. Ooh. Yeah. Oh yeah, it's fantastic.
Sounds super duper cool.
Yeah, and there's this place called Cooper's Cabin. It's this hidden cabin up like hidden away, and it's actually on the Appalachian Trail. But like from the top of Killington, when you get off the lift, you go down this little trail down to this cabin. It's like this huge like 420 hangout, and apparently every year there on 420 there's this massive party. Like hundreds of people show up and stuff.
How long is the drive?
I think it's like 4 hours.
Really? It's like going to New York.
It's not.
That was gonna be more than that. Like
well, it depends on where you're going from. So like when we went last year, we actually left from I think like North Jersey, so that's why it was 4 hours. But if we were to go from here, Philadelphia, it'd be closer to 6 probably.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
It's a drive, but it's
no,
worth
it's worth it.
It.
I would agree. Let's see. Checking down my list. Rabbits. Yeah, the Steve Furness ride. How did that come across?
Oh, man. I have to thank my girlfriend for that one. She's fantastic. She has this fling with Reddit right now. And it all started out with this weird letter that was like left around like the area where like 27th and Girard was. It was this strange letter. It was a little... Actually, I don't think I have it up here, but we have a huge like printout of the actual original letter.
Gotcha.
And it's hard to explain. It was this weird letter that talked about like melting everything you've eaten since the first grade together and like turning yourself into a steel statue.
Yeah, it was a wild concept.
Yeah, it was out there. We ended up actually meeting the original guy who wrote it.
He was in a wheelchair.
He was an older African American gentleman. I don't remember what his problem was exactly, but he was a little out there.
Yeah, I would like some kind of mental illness. I would like to think.
Something like that. Yeah, but we were just gonna go to this thing. We had no idea like what it was gonna turn out to be because it was supposed to be held on a vacant lot on the corner of like 27th and Girard.
What did you think was gonna happen? If anything,
honestly, I didn't know. Well, going into it, we thought like people were going to try to capitalize off of this viral thing, you know, because it had all this support. Like the group on Facebook had like a couple thousand people that had RSVP'd. They're going to show up. So like I was a little concerned, like one, because like there's going to be a lot of people there. So you didn't know what was going to go down.
Right.
And I don't know. It was. We expected like a bunch of like food trucks to show up and like people to like try and vend there or something, but no one did that at all. No one except for us. So like we had this idea. It was like, well, you know, why don't we like bring some speakers and a generator and like play some music?
Yeah.
You know, and it ended up being like probably one of the best decisions we could have made.
Yeah.
You know, it was a shot in the dark. And I was a little nervous because, like, we didn't know
Nobody knew what the fuck was going to happen.
Yeah,
really.
We had no idea. Like, we didn't know if the cops were going to show up and shut us down or, like, the owner of whatever that lot was going to shut us down. We were afraid of our stuff maybe getting stolen because you have, like, 2,000 people and 1,200 square foot vacant lot and shit goes down. You know, you don't know what's going to happen. Someone could grab one of my $2,000 CDJs and dip, you know? But, you know, it ended up being absolutely amazing. They had like an upwards of like almost 1,000 people show up, all crammed into this lot. We were the only people there that brought music. So like we were getting thanked by all these Redditors afterwards. Like people were paying us money, like just giving us money. Like, thank you for doing this. Like this wouldn't have become as amazing as it was if you didn't do it. If you didn't come out here and play music, it would have been a bunch of weird people standing in a vacant lot, you know? So, like...
Was there anybody else doing anything else? Like, no shit.
No. I mean, some people brought, like, some different stuff. Some people made banners, like, related to it. Some people made T-shirts. Yeah,
there was a bike ride that was happening that I went on after. Yep. And it was like the Steel Furnace ride. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. There was a bunch of bars in the local area that were doing like before and after party things.
Okay.
So like they tried to capitalize on it, and like I figured it would be an amazing opportunity for us to like sort of try and get our name out there. And it was fantastic. We ended up getting covered by like 6 different media sources. We were in like
fucking everywhere.
Yeah. It was in the paper. It was on the news. It was just, I wish that the television news actually would have, you know, given us a little more, like, you know, attention.
6 ABC Live.
Yeah.
Look what's happening in this random park. Oh, we got this drum and bass band playing in the back.
If they
would have
got our Curvis shirts in there or something, I would have been ecstatic, you know, but Emily actually got interviewed and she had a little interview put on the news. That was pretty cool.
I think I remember that one. I don't know. I think it was maybe like Fox or I forget whom. I remember seeing that interview. That was Boss. It's just, you should make it like a... You should do another one
and
like
make
a fake letter.
Yeah,
and like spread it like, oh, I'm back and I got these crazy ass thoughts. Meet me at this place on this date, bitch. Like, see what happens.
Well, I mean, it's a specific kind of marketing. It's called what's the name of it?
It's gotta be some random ass marketing though.
It's like it's not like ghetto marketing. It's like. it's like something you do that like isn't necessarily like it draws your eye differently, you know. Like say for example, like in New York, like Dunkin' Donuts did a thing where they put like a giant coffee cup over top of like a one of those manhole covers, and it looked like a steaming pot of coffee.
I get you.
Or like the God damn it, I can't remember the fucking name of the kind of marketing it is. But like doing something that draws someone's eye away. Like
I got you.
But something we really wanted to do is like when we are thrown an event at like a specific party or something, you know, like go out and use sidewalk chalk.
Yeah.
Instead of, because people are constantly looking down at the ground with their phones and whatnot. Like it'd be something that's different, draws your eye.
Speaking of marketing, I've had this discussion last time about marketing with Brian. And we were discussing like flyers, like how like this being postal and putting your name out there, I feel is still something despite, you know, all the Facebook marketing that goes on and like putting your, you know, your party on Instagram.
I hate Facebook.
Yeah, I hate it. It's dated.
Its algorithms are a real pain in the ass. It is so hard for us to get noticed by the right people without dishing out tons of money. And that's just so infuriating because unless you're paying for the advertisement, they literally hold you back. Yep. Like, we don't even get organic exposure anymore. They purposely hold you back. They don't share your things to your friends because they want you to pay.
Right.
You know, and that's so frustrating. And like, I see, like, we've actually done flyering, like, for some of our events. Mm-hmm. The turnout you actually get from flyering is debatable. But
agreed.
But, you know, I'm dying to find a new way to like get a hold of people or get them interested in something or get them to attend something. I want to try and innovate somehow.
Here's my idea. But first, Facebook is a dated platform. It's a 10-year-old plus platform, and it's on the stock market. And I knew when it was going to be on the stock market that things were going to be going to take a turn.
Yep.
And you know, with how big that platform is, it's super integrated into everything, which sucks because it's like, how can you take it down when it's like an integral part of like what device, you know, whatever device. And also just as well, you know, it's integration with Instagram, which is basically kind of like the same thing.
Yeah.
So it's kind of redundant, you know, so it's like, you know, what's kind of the next big thing?
Yeah.
And you know, if it's going to be something big, it has to be like as big as Facebook. So it's kind of like, it's something that I want to see, but I doubt that's ever going to happen considering its market share.
Yeah.
And but you know, at the same time, you know, just not too long ago, Facebook went down. You know, you couldn't see any photos or anything like that. And the only told like the shareholders about that like hours afterwards, I guess. Yeah. I'm not sure where. I think they're headquartered in California, so maybe California knew about it first before everybody else did. Yeah. But still, I feel they could do a better job of what they're doing. So I'm like, the only reason I'm on Facebook now is because, you know, everybody else is on Facebook. That's it.
Yeah, that's the only reason I'm there. You know, I end up getting drawn into political conversations a lot, and I don't want to get into politics.
Yeah, I don't want to get into politics either, but it's like,
it's bad. And especially with the way their algorithms work, like they intentionally, like if they know that you're commenting on stuff, like it'll purposely give you more of that stuff.
Right.
So that it encourages you to argue with people.
Or like even if like even marketing wise, like I just bought these new shoes, I bought these new Vans. Oh, like all of a sudden like these, considering your search history will pop up.
You're searching on Google and then you see ads on your Facebook, you know, you're selling your information.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's another thing to privacy these days just as well. But going back to marketing, I've always theorized like if I ever become big enough and or bad the opportunity like to kind of market or promote a party at a party with like no hold bound, like unlimited money, whatever. I've always thought about going back to street art, like doing graffiti. Like imagine if like you posted or did a tag with like with your name, well not your name but because
you have to be careful with that because I remember when we had our first party at Sprout, Cody actually went up there and he was leaving flyers all around the college.
Right.
While we ended up getting a phone call from the police.
Gotcha.
It turns out you're not allowed to do that. So like it's hard to try and promote something when you know it can be traced back to you, especially with something like graffiti, which is illegal.
Right.
So, I mean, I love the idea, and like when it comes to that sort of underground kind of thing, and I think it needs to move back into the underground. It needs to move away from the spotlight and not be as this huge popular thing that's been turned into this commercial thing.
Right.
But, you know, like back when like raves first started coming around, like I heard from all these different old heads talking about how they promoted for them. And it was like you would get like an email address from someone, and then you would get an email which would give you directions. And it would send you to one place, and you meet another, meet a like a
that's
guy
exactly
that
how.
There.
Or if you got the phone number, like yeah, there'll be from Brian, like there'll be like multiple phone numbers on like one flyer, and one of those numbers would be like the map point. Okay, this is where you go. But if you wanted tickets, you call the other numbers depending on where you were at.
Yeah,
like in the zip code. Okay, if you were in Philly, you can call this number. If you were,
it was like a puzzle.
Kind of, you know? Yes, and that it was more like a riddle. I love that concept. Yeah. I think that should be brought back.
I know,
as well.
Me too. I'm fascinated with that. I wish we could go back to doing something like that. But you know, like especially millennials, people our age, they need that instant gratification.
Yeah,
you know, they need to like get what they want when they want it. Mm-hmm. No one wants to go through the process.
Right, the process. Know? The closest thing to that these days is like kind of the more secret parties.
Yeah,
where it's like, oh, you get tickets, but you don't know the location. The location is disclosed. Let's say at like midnight.
Yeah,
and it's like, okay, everybody goes there, kind of sort of. But as far as like really drawing it out, that's kind of lost.
Yeah, yeah, because people don't have the attention spans anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the whole problem with Facebook and Instagram is it messes with your attention span.
Yeah.
You know, especially having ADHD myself, it compounds on that and makes it so much worse. You know, but I love the idea. I've heard all these amazing stories like how, like, you know, you got sent to one person and that person had the address.
Yeah.
And if that person didn't think you were cool, right.
Follow that guy with the funny hat.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the guy I need to meet up. But if that guy didn't think you were cool,
he would send you elsewhere, or he would give you the wrong address.
Ooh.
If you thought you were a narc or something, he'd be like, oh, it's on 25th Street, you know, and then he would send you somewhere bogus.
Right.
You know, and so it was a good way to weed out people that, you know, but then, you know, the guy doing the weeding out, you know, like, who knows what he thought was cool and what.
I've always wondered that, though, with doorman.
Yeah.
I've always wondered, we were talking again last podcast, but anyway, How do people get in the door if there's a doorman? Is it based on dress code? What do I have to wear? Based on what I have to wear, what's the clientele like? Depending on what kind of, like, what are you looking for as a doorman? Like, how do I get into this event that I want to be a part of? But let's say I don't get it. What did I miss? You know, what are they looking for? It's always been kind of like a mystery to me, and how to, like, essentially, again, and even though you may have a ticket, it still may be like, no.
Yeah, you know, I don't like your shorts.
You know. Yeah, yes.
So, like, I don't know. I think, like, doormen they have their own sort of personality. It depends on how they're feeling that day, too. You know,
yeah.
And it depends on who you know. Because, like, I've been to Noto before wearing, like, cargo shorts and a t-shirt.
Ooh.
But okay. Because I was, like, I had a camera, like, you know, around my neck, you know, and I was with my buddy Cody, who was one of the DJs for the night. They just let me right in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they didn't say a thing to me.
Right.
But like, if I would have just showed up there, and I was wearing cargo shorts, a pair of sneakers, and a t-shirt, they'd have been like, "Go the fuck home."
Yeah.
And change.
If do you remember going to Rumor? Have you ever been to Rumor?
Honestly, I think I've been there before.
Okay. They have like the vault, like this big bank vault downstairs that you can go inside of.
You know what? Maybe I haven't. I was to Lit Ultra Bar. I was at
Ultra Bar. That was my place too.
That place was cool with that big LED wall.
Oh, I got that stack of speakers.
Yeah,
it's like, dude, if you were in front of it, your heartbeat would skip.
Yep.
It was just crazy.
I went there like one time that was memorable, and that was for New Year's with an old buddy of mine, Cody, and we bought like VIP tickets for everything. We had like the open bar.
Drinks are fucking expensive as shit. Like, oh, you wanted this? You wanted like this little
yeah,
mix,
you got, like,
15
a little,
bucks.
Little plastic cup that's like barely a shot.
Yep.
It's like, yeah, oh my god.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
But like with Rumor, the doorman there was his name was T-Fish.
Mm-hmm.
And he was given a business card. It's like, but I noticed, like, depending on how he was feeling.
If he had a bad day that day.
Right. If he had a bad day, that he would like kind of like be like, nope, like, that's it. Nope, go. But if you like, he'd be, at least in my head, if you were out towards the front of the line, And like, you know, you let him take his time. You know,
you were rushing him. You weren't trying to get in
fast. Exactly.
You didn't show impatience.
You know? Right. Exactly. Like, you know, he knew a bunch of people in the city, and or he knew the people that he was going to get, like the regulars. He knew he wanted to say what's up and hey, hi, yeah. What's up? You know, even if it was a car passing by and he just happened to knew the guy in the car, he'd be like, hey, yo, what's up? He'd be like, okay, yo. And, you know, just have a quick conversation, and then he'll go back to you or to whomever, and if him or her, you know, was cool, you know, he would let him in eventually.
I mean, I can see why, and I can see the benefit of doing that, because, like, I think you can cut down on a lot of assholes at a party like that.
Yeah, it's kind of, it's crowd control to a degree, for the better.
Yeah, so, like, you know, you take your time, you don't let too many people in at once, mm-hmm. You don't let the wrong kind of people in. Yep. You know, I remember I went to Pasha, New York City once, and I went with my buddy Shane. We ended up drinking like a fifth of vodka on the hour-long train ride. A fifth of vodka in an hour on a train ride into the city. And then we get to Pasha, and like my buddy's wiling out. Like he's clearly shit-faced. I know, so was I. But the way I held myself, the way I hid my drunkenness, like they stopped my buddy real quick. But then I thought they were stopping me too. Right. And I was like, dude, you just got to chill out, man. Like, just go in and act like you're not drunk.
Did he have the bottle on him?
Like, no, we didn't. No, we didn't.
Oh, okay, so I'm guessing you finished it?
Oh, yeah, we finished it on the train.
Okay.
Yeah, I was, that was a memorable night, to say the least. But, you know, we ended up having this thing. Like, he was like, well, we're not going to get in there. And I'm like, watch me, dude. I went up there and I got right in. And they didn't say shit to me. And I'm like in the club, like, dude, you just gotta chill out.
Now, did you feel guilty getting in, or was it like, oh, no. I can't go in without him? Well, like, we're buddies, man. We gotta make this together.
Well, see, like, what had happened was I had got in, and then I had, like, went up to somebody in there. And I was like, dude, these fucking asshole bouncers won't let my boy in. Like, he's a little drunk, but, like, he's not wiling. You know, I'm just as drunk as he is.
Okay.
So, like, you know, this chick comes out with me, and she's like, yo, let him in.
Okay.
But, like, it was already at the point where, like, he was like, I'm out of this bitch.
Gotcha.
Drop mic. You know, like, he was like, yo, man, you know, just, like, take the train at 7 a.m. I'll see you later. And I'm like, dude, you're not fucking leaving me alone in New York City. Alone. You're like, I've never been in New York City alone, and you're just about to leave me at a club? I have, like, nothing on me. Right. I didn't bring a car. I have no way to get home. Like, so instead of, I ended up just leaving, you know? So, but, you know, the whole night ended up unfolding pretty cool, you know? We ended up stopping at some, like, corner bodega, getting some food, and then we went bar hopping for a little bit. And, like, it sucked because we missed the main event, something I had paid, like, $30-some for a ticket to go see. I think it was Too Loud or something.
Okay.
And
not to mention all the travel costs just to get there.
Well, yeah, I mean, I did have to drive all the way up to, like, Connecticut. And then, like, we took a train from just outside the city into the city instead of, like, driving in there.
Yeah.
Honestly, that was probably one of the smartest
ideas.
That's
the move to do. That's the move to do. Driving in there is chaos.
The only issue is leaving.
Kind of, sort of. How was it? Oh, I've heard because the train
station is closed
late.
Until like 6 or 7 a.m. So like we couldn't get into Grand Central until like 6 a.m. So like we had to find, and bars in New York City close at like 5. So like we had to spend
really, I thought most of them were like 2. I guess like the more after hour spots, like Mirage.
Yeah, I mean, I know Pasha was open till like, I was there until like 8 a.m. You would never want to be there that late, and I learned why, because all the weirdos show up. Because like, it comes to like, it's like 6 or 7 in the morning, and like, you just have a bunch of like weird trannies in the place, you know?
Gotcha.
They're throwing off weird vibes, and they're playing weird bachata music, and you're just like waking up from a trip like, what the fuck am I doing here?
it's so odd though, like, I'm... For a subsurface party, I fell asleep at it. I've never fallen asleep like on the floor. Like there was like a random chair like in the corner of the room, and I was like, okay, I'm just gonna sit down real quick and just kind of like, cause I had a few drinks, so I was just like, okay, let me just gather myself. And sure enough, like
next thing you know, the bouncer's off, shaking
like,
you.
No. Like some girl was like shaking my shoulder, and I was like, where the fuck am I? Like, I have no idea where the fuck I am. There's like strobe lights going off and shit. There's loud ass music. How the fuck do I sleep through this shit?
Yeah.
But it took like two or three minutes to like regain like control and like figure out where the fuck I was at. And turns out I was in the same place I was at the whole time.
Yeah.
But it was like, man, that was a trip just as well. I remember seeing it was Anthony I'm bad with names. Anthony Parasol. There we go. And okay. he was kind of the resident at Berghain.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember that name, like Berghain. Oh man, that's a big club in Germany. Okay, yeah, I got to see this dude. It was a great event. I loved it for every second. Now, Pacha. I've never been to Pacha. Never been to Output. I haven't really endeavored into New York.
Pacha was cool, but I heard rumors a lot of the locals didn't like it. They thought it was like, you know, trashy. But I thought it was really neat. It was like when you like went into this place, you went up like three sets of stairs, okay, and then you came out into like a mezzanine that looked down on the main dance floor.
Okay.
And then from there, you would take another staircase down to where the main floor was. And then they even had another basement room, which had like a third DJ in it. So you had like three different rooms. And then like they had this huge mezzanine. They actually had to put like plexiglass up because I don't know if they were afraid people were going to fall or whatever, or you know how drunk people are.
Mm-hmm.
But it was neat because they had these CO2 cannons mounted at the top of this mezzanine. So like it would just pour ice cold CO2 yes, down on this whole floor. Yeah. And when you're in there and you're like,
shit.
Oh my God, it's like the coolest heaven feeling in the world.
Literally. Yeah. Did you feel lost though when you were in that place? Like we were like, okay, I'm on this floor, but like how do I get back to like the smoking area?
Once you sort of discover where everything is, like once you do that one little loop around, okay, you know where everything is, it's pretty easy to like find your way.
For me, it's like I feel like kind of like we're losing that as far as like the American clubs, like just that feeling of getting lost. And I feel that's,
they're not big enough anymore.
It's they're not big enough in that regard, and they only open for like maybe 1 to 3 years before they shut down. If they last like 10 plus, that's a godsend.
Yeah.
But like I always like that feeling of getting lost in a place, because mm-hmm, you don't like.
How to describe new it? Music festivals are a good way to explain it. New music festivals, you had never been there before. Like you know what Big Dub is, right?
Yeah.
You ever been there?
No.
Well, that like the first time going to any music festival, it's like you feel like a kid in a candy shop. There's just so much to do, so much to explore. And like that's amazing when you can get that in a club. Mm-hmm. You know, if a club's got multiple rooms, yep, like a bunch of different atmospheres, basically. You know, and that's really neat to explore.
Yeah, it's like you get lost in the music, and it's like no matter what's playing, you have an ear for it just as well. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what genre.
Yeah.
And with that just as well, it's like getting lost in the music, you're getting like getting lost in the club. Is like you're getting lost in music. Like everything is everything else. Everything is kind of like one genre, and you're constantly like listening and exploring, mm-hmm, whether that be on some kind of crazy like trip on like whatever drug, or just like hanging with buddies and just like having a conversation, or like going to this room and be like, oh, look at the lighting, and like the sound's crazy. It's off the wall, and you're just getting like lost in like all these visuals, all this sound.
Yep.
Which I feel is important, and it's kind of in that same regard of festivals as well. I went to Firefly not too long ago. Well, I went to Ashfly, I should say, not too long ago. But I've been to Firefly before, mm-hmm, and it's like again, just as well. You have to, you kind of get lost.
Yeah.
But that's in the good thing. You know, you have kind of like 3 to 4 days to kind of settle in, but you know, there may be 2 or 3 acts performing at the same time who you want to see.
See, that's the difficult thing. That's the one thing that really sucks. Like when I went to Ultra, it was like Ultra is like lots of really huge artists.
Same time.
And like you are forced to choose between one or another.
Yes. And it's like a 15-minute walk between each stage.
Yep. So it's like, not like, man, oh, I'll catch half an hour of him and then go over to watch him.
No, you can't do that.
It's like a half hour walk to get to the other stage. So it's like once you find a place, you stay there.
Yes.
You know, like, and then like maybe switch like in the middle of someone's set when you know some guy is coming on 45 minutes later.
Yeah.
You know, but you know.
Do they have like at Ultra, being that I've never been there, do they have like kind of like, you know, when you go to like the Jersey Shore, you have these like little taxis kind of that ferry you?
No. It wasn't
Ultra, if you're listening. Give it to the other stage. I'll pay you $2. Okay, cool. Oh, no, I got my pass. Okay, I'll just let you go.
I love the variety of the different stages they had. They had some smaller ones. Mm-hmm. You know, they had one that was just like this weird, like, semicircle that mm-hmm. had all those LED screens on it, like a section of the trance stage.
Mm-hmm.
And then they had, this really cool one they had where they were playing, like, Deep House and stuff like that. They had, like, this weird metallic octopus thing that was, like, shooting fire out of it.
Was it octopus or a spider?
I don't remember what it was, but... I was so fucked up that whole week. But that was interesting. It was different. They had, like, platforms that you could, like, get up on and dance on and stuff. And then they had, like, another stage yet that was, like a natural amphitheater with, like, a grass, like... They had, like, seating down below, and then they had, like, a grass, like, amphitheater sort of thing.
I get you. Oh, I'm guessing they were playing, like, more chill.
Well, actually, I saw Porter Robinson there. That was probably one of the most memorable sets I saw at all of Ultra.
Very distinctive sound, that guy.
He, like, more anime.
His visuals are awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. It goes along with his entire set, like, it's curated. And when we heard him, we heard his live set. So he was actually, performing the songs on like keyboards and drum machines and everything. Like it wasn't just a DJ set. Cause I know he just DJs too, but it was fascinating to see that. I had like this huge like moment there. Like I started like bawling my eyes out watching him. And it was like, it sounds kind of pathetic, but you know, after a week.
But you connected with that.
Yeah. I mean, like, you know, you're doing illicit substances and whatnot, you know, it messes with your emotions. So like it was like near the end of the festival too. Mm-hmm. And it was like this sort of moment where like, I was just so happy just to be there, just to have experienced mm-hmm. it, just to like, just let all the other problems in my life melt away. And I could just truly enjoy it. You know, a year or two before then I had went through like a really bad breakup and you know, I didn't know what I wanted to do with my life. And you know, it was just, Ultra was like that focal point, that changing moment in my life where I like really decided like I really want to just try and pursue music more. Mm-hmm. I want to be a more of a part of it. I want to see it more. I want to I just love music so much. And it was like a huge culmination of everything for me.
Now, speaking of culmination, a lot of people have a different amalgamation of all these different images that they have in their body. Tattoos.
Yeah.
Do you have any tattoos? I definitely see them.
I have, I don't know how many. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So most of them are music, actually. So like the boat.
Mm-hmm.
This is Parkway Drive. The birds are actually Incubus. The sunflower is Stone Temple Pilots.
Hey, Incubus, I remember that.
And the tree is the Devil Wears Prada. Do you know who they are?
Do not.
They had an album called with Roots Above and Branches Below. So it's similar to the album artwork, but the artist that did this, my friend Vic, she actually drew it mm-hmm. before she put it in my skin. So it's completely original. It's not copied from anywhere. And then of course I have my Deftones tattoo.
Now, I'm seeing a lot of Juno Beats like logo. Yeah, seeing that a lot.
That's a huge popular thing.
Yeah, it's a huge thing.
I used to be huge into trance, like in Juno and Above and Beyond. That was like my thing.
Did you see him at Fillmore?
I don't think I saw him at the Fillmore. I saw him in DC a time or two. I saw them at Moonrise. I forget who was playing. It wasn't Bass Nectar. Oh, it was Die Antwoord. I chose to see Above and Beyond over Die Antwoord. My girlfriend would hate that. She loves that Die Antwoord. She's bored to tears with trance music. But, you know, at that time of my life, you know, it was a very uplifting sort of style of music, you know. Yeah. So, like, and the people that you met there were very, you know.
And trance had their time, like, two years ago. Like, trance, that was it.
Yep.
That was all mostly playing. But, you know, it comes in phases. Like, from what I heard first, like at Ultra, it was, like, Deep House, and then EDM, and then trance. And now I'm guessing techno is kind of the thing now.
Yeah.
But that's Ultra though. It kind of
evolves.
I don't want to say it comes and goes, but you know, different genres of music have like their time, at mm-hmm. least in a festival kind of setting.
Yeah,
it's only when you go to the cities that more like it resonates more. It kind of culminates more.
Yeah.
Now, since you've been to New York, going back to New York, Is there more of a bass house kind of scene, or is it like very much varied? Is it more like diverse as far as
very, very diverse? But I know, it's diverse in the aspect of a lot of house, a lot of drum and bass. Like I have a ton of drum and bass friends that are in New York. I know the scene is much, much larger there than it probably has ever been.
What's the place to go if I were to listen to some drum and bass in New York?
I don't think there's any specific kind of club or anything. You would have to look for a specific event with specific artists, or you would have to follow a specific collective that does that kind of stuff. Like, find out what collectives do drum and bass. What?
Gotcha. Now, it's like, I've always kind of wondered that, because it's like, I feel like the sound coming out of New York now is primarily techno, but I wouldn't know, considering I'm more into that kind of scene and more into house just as well. So I kind of wanted a different perspective. That's why I asked you the question. And also just as well, they opened this new place called Basement.
Okay.
And it's like primarily techno driven, but I'm like, is that all that's coming from New York? And being how it is, I would like to think it's definitely more diverse. I know it is.
I actually, I just went to, not long ago, World of Drum and Bass, which is a big party they have annually. It's like a touring thing. They go to a bunch of different cities. Mm-hmm. And the venue they had, that was amazing, man. It was really cool. And not only that, like the way the bar worked there was kind of neat too. Like when you walked in, you could get like a wristband.
Okay.
And then it had like an RFID chip in it, and like you would load money onto that. So like when you would go to the bar, you would just scan the RFID chip instead of like dealing with money and shit.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. But then like apparently there was like another event going on at the same venue. It was like a warehouse complex sort of.
Okay.
So like you walked in and there was like a house thing going on over here and like something else in the other room. And then you walked outside. And there was like this old like circus tent looking thing. And apparently it's like it came from like Europe somewhere.
Okay.
You know, like it's like this movable thing. And you walked in and there's this huge disco ball and you see the red and white stripes across.
I'm
the
thinking
thing.
Like Cirque du Soleil kind of style right now. Kind of sort of.
Yeah. It was fascinating that like how it looked old. You know, it didn't look like, you know,
modern.
Yeah. And it wasn't like a tent either. Like it had a wooden floor and like it had like windows all around it. And like inside they had this amazing light set up, like, cause it was all at a big circle.
Yeah.
So like they had the lights like timed with like the disco ball and stuff in the center. And that was a fantastic show. We actually ended up like staying at some random person's house from Airbnb in Brooklyn when we went to go do that. But it was, I had some of the best coffee I've ever had in my life the next morning. You're just walking around Brooklyn, discovering, like, you know, where we are and what's around us. That was, it was such a good time. But the show was incredible. Like, you don't get that kind of stuff here in Philadelphia. You don't get, like, drum sound and bassline Smith. And some of the, like, the last guy was this fucking white dude that murdered this jungle set, man. He was amazing.
But it's come back now that we have Rainforest.
Yeah.
Well, at the bar,
I'm a big fan of that. I like DJ Ha. I like them. They're cool people. And Jungle Room. I just went to their park party recently. Mm-hmm. That was really cool. It's so refreshing. And there was a decent crowd there.
Yes,
too,
it was
for jungle music. And I'm like, this is fucking amazing. Yeah. I made a point to get in contact with them, and throw them my business cards, and try to get some stuff from them. I'd love to like book these guys.
And with Shakedown just as well.
Yeah.
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 Speaking of which, thank you for the coffee. By the way.
Yeah, of course, man.
Now, Cozy's doing his thing with coffee.
That guy. Love that guy so much.
I love that dude.
His coffee is fantastic, man. I wish him all the best.
It's good. And for me, like, the majority of the time I have coffee, it's got to be hot.
Yeah.
It's either, like, a morning thing.
Yeah.
Or a late night thing. It used to be, like, an evening kind of thing.
Yeah.
But now I feel it's, like, a late night and or morning kind of thing. But then I tried Cozy. Then I tried Cody's stuff. And it was cold, so I was kind of looking like hesitant, like, what the fuck is this? But I'll try it out of respect. It was good. It's he's got his website up now, and I think he just
CozyCoffee.com, guys.
Yeah, CozyCoffee.com.
K-O-Z-I-I, CozyCoffee.com.
There you go. He made it on Squarespace, and I think he just got a cooler earlier today. I saw his Instagram. I think he just got a cooler, and I invited him to this, like, bike race that he can potentially sell his coffee this coming Saturday. you know, hopefully he'll show up and sell some if he does decide to show up. But I wish him all the best of luck with that venture, just as well. And I hope it's profitable for him because it's good stuff.
Dude, I have a lot of respect for him because, like, he's, like, doing his own thing and he's, like, starting his own business. Because, like, for me, like, I've had trouble with jobs my whole life just because I can't help but feeling like a statistic or a number on a piece of paper.
I understand.
I'm making somebody else money. I'm busting my balls so some other CEO somewhere can reap the benefits of it. And so I've always wanted to have my own business. I work Lyft full time now. You know, even though I'm working through a company, I'm an independent contractor. I make my own hours. I work whenever I want. I can work as long as I want. You know, so I have the freedom to go and do wherever, whatever I want, whenever I want to do it.
Have you tried Amazon Flex? That's what I'm in. I'm working on that. I've been working with Amazon Flex for like 8 or 9 months.
What is that exactly?
It's sure. Like instead of delivering people or delivering food, you deliver
packages.
Huh. You play mailman.
Huh.
And you go to the warehouse. You pick a shift on your phone, and you know you pick it. Let's say a block, which is basically a shift. Like it could be a 3-hour shift or a 4-hour shift.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say from whatever to whatever. Let's say 1:30 to like 5:30. You know, you pick that shift on your phone, you get to the warehouse at 1:30, you load up your vehicle with all the packages, you play kind of like Tetris, So you put the big packages in the trunk, you know, put the small packages in front, and then from there, Amazon has their own built-in app.
It directs you where to drop each one.
Now, granted, the GPS could be better, it's not Google Maps, so every once in a while they put you in the middle of nowhere, and you're like, where the fuck, and then you just go on Google Maps and hopefully you have a connection. And once you do get that connection, you know, go to the person's house, deliver the package on their doorstep, and move on to the next one and repeat.
That's interesting. I didn't even know that was a thing.
It is a thing. They do have, check that out. Amazon just had opened a warehouse in Philly.
What's the pay nearby, like?
It's nearby Grays Ferry. I think it's like $20 an hour. Like, as an example.
Do you get paid like is it hourly or is it by like
by the blocks? It's okay. By each shift. But here's the thing: like, you get paid twice a week.
Oh wow!
So it's every Tuesday and Friday.
Huh.
But you know, you could end up getting 5 blocks a week.
Wow.
Or you could end up getting 1 a week. It kind of depends on the availability.
That's pretty interesting.
It is. It's cool. But usually, as far as pay is concerned, let's say you work a 3-hour block.
Mm-hmm.
The minimum is for a 3-hour block is $54. The minimum for a 3.5 is $63. The minimum for 4 hours is $72. And it can escalate from there. Now they have 5-hour blocks, but it kind of detracts from what the pay was for a 4-hour. It used to be like a 4-hour block used to be like $80
that
plus.
That sounds like a lot more of a like a better than like what I'm doing now with Lyft. Because like Lyft is like, it's dependent on like if it's busy, what day of the week it is, what time of the fucking day it is. Like
I agree. And I looked into that as well. And I was like, there's an Amazon warehouse right nearby me. So I was like, I'm going to try it. And I was one of the early adopters of that.
Yeah.
And, it has its ups and downs, but I like it. I like it. You're not, you know.
It sounds like the pay. You're
in consistent
control of
your
to
pay. A degree. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Because like the big problem
with
Lyft.
You have to deal with a boss.
Yeah. Like one day I'll, well, that, you know, but like with Lyft, you know, one day I'll make $10 an hour and the next I'll make $35 or $40 an hour.
Yeah.
You know, like I'll sometimes get a ride out to Allentown, make $100 for what, 2 hours there and back.
Right.
So, like, that's fantastic, but then, you know, your average weekday, it's like, you know, I go out and work from, like, 9 till 9,
yep.
And the pay is inconsistent. You know, like, I'll make $75 in that time one night. I'll make, like, $150 in that time another night. It's ugh.
Have you done late nights?
That's
is that, like, peak time? What's peak time?
Peak times would probably be, like, in the morning. Like when people are going to work, and then in the evening when people are coming home from work. But I can't stand those evenings, man, because especially here in Philly, like I don't make shit. Like the money is terrible, especially in the evening, because like you're picking somebody up and you know everyone else is going home, like especially if it's in Center City. And it's like you drive like a mile and a half and it takes 25 minutes to drive that mile and a half. And I get paid by the mile, not by how long the drive is. So, like, if I get, I'll get like $6 for 25 minutes of my time. You know, it's just not worth
it. It's not worth it. I would say just definitely check out Amazon Flex. You have to go, just like Google, download Amazon Flex app. Everything is done through the app.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, through the tutorial, what you have to do, and then they get you, your information down, take a photo of your license, and they, you know, they process you.
So just like Lyft, yeah.
Kind of, so yeah, it takes a little while to process.
They need your driver's information, they need to do a background check, that kind of stuff, okay.
Yeah, same process, but I would suggest that. But I've noticed it beats up your car. Like, your car takes
trust me, I do miles. Lyft, I know.
Especially. And that's one thing, like, that's why I had to do my brakes earlier today.
Yeah.
Because when I bought the car, the brakes were, they weren't in the best of shape to begin with.
What kind of car are you driving?
I got a 2011 Volkswagen Jetta Sport Wagon.
It's a Volkswagen. I used
to be... Well, they have electrical gremlins, but solid car compared to what I had. It's a solid car, man.
Well, I used to be huge into German cars. I actually went to tech school for cars for a little bit.
Oh, so did I. Look at that.
I went to, where'd you go? I went to UTI.
I went to Delaware Tech. It was a community college, but they had an automotive technology course.
Yeah. So I went there for a little bit. I had a huge passion for cars until I went to school for it. And it, like, killed that love of cars for me. You know, I haven't touched a car in that way since,
For me, it I don't want to say rekindled it, but it, like, gave me more motivation to actually work on it.
Yeah.
Because I'm more book smart when it comes to cars. Not really hands-on, but now that I've had, you know, a couple cars here and there, it's, like, I'm more hands-on.
Oh, yeah.
Just doing general maintenance. Yeah. Not throwing, like, a turbo on it.
Yeah, I can change my own brakes. I can change my oil. I switched out... a piece of a transmission. Like, I ended up dropping a whole transmission out of my old Audi.
Yeah. What was it? S4?
TT.
Oh.
Yeah, I love that car. That was my fuckboy car. My dad actually still has it.
What was it, the 5-cylinder or the 4-cylinder?
They're only 4-cylinders. Okay. It was a 1.8T.
Gotcha.
It was all-wheel drive.
Yes, it was. I think the new TTRS, the 5-cylinder. Okay, yeah,
those are awesome. Yes. I think that's a Volvo engine. That straight five.
Yeah,
that's a Volvo engine. That's an incredible engine, man. Those things are quick.
I have the my little Jetta, the 2.5 naturally aspirated, and I think they're reliable because one, they hold more oil, and two, it's electric. It's a what's the terminology for
it? Hybrid?
No. It's the power steering rack is electric.
Oh, okay.
So there's no power steering.
Yeah.
And I was actually looking when I first got the car. I was like, "Where's the power steering fluid? Oh, it's electric rack. Oh, you don't have to do that shit. Oh, really? This is crazy cool."
I love German cars. I've always been a huge fan of Volkswagens. But
did you have a Volkswagen? And which one?
Yes, I did. Yes, I had a Mark II GTI from '91.
Of course you did.
I love the shit out of that motherfucker. I love the shit out of that car. It had a VR6 swap in it, actually.
Ooh.
A 91 fancy. GTI. That thing was like
exhaust.
Of course. That thing was like it was like a tin box with a jet engine strapped to it. I can't tell you how many times I almost killed myself in that car. It had no airbags. It had one of those like
if shit went wrong, you knew about it.
Yeah. But like, I just love the simplicity of it because it was just so mechanically sound. Mm-hmm. You know, like early
was it five
German
speed.
Car.
Five speed.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Oh, no, it was a VR6, so it was 6-speed. Oh, wait, no, it was 5-speed. That's my bad. It was a while ago when I owned this car.
That's
what. I only owned it for a short amount of time. I ended up selling it because I thought I was going to kill myself in it.
Okay. But I understand. I had my first car was a Nissan Sentra 1.8. And it was like 2004. A lot of people still ride around with it, but they have no ABS despite being somewhat modern.
Yeah.
Small little engine. I think it's like a 1.8. Yeah, 1.8. But I had the special edition. So it had the wing. It had like the body kit with like the rock perfoscate system. It had a sub in the back. So it was.
I used to be big into the whole subs
tint.
Thing.
I had tint. Now, granted, it wasn't factory tint, but it had tint.
Yeah.
And one night I used that to my advantage. And it was a good night. Well, it was surprising. That was interesting. I won't discuss that here. But it was interesting. But I had tint. It was kind of cool. I never got really pulled over for it because in Delaware, you can get away with having like a tint in the rear.
Yeah.
And not being having, as long as it's not too dark, you can get away with it.
Yeah.
And it was cool. But now I got my Jetta and it's, you know, stability control, ABS, all these creature comforts. It's solid. Now the reason why I got the Volkswagen is because I went over to Germany earlier in January, and I went to the Volkswagen factory.
Oh, so you know what Volkswagen means?
Well, here's the thing. No, because
it means the people's car.
No, it is the people's Volkswagen. Car. But the thing is, though, I went on the tour, and my train, I was going from Berlin. I stayed there for a week in Berlin. I was going from Berlin to Wolfsburg, mm-hmm. where the plan is, hence the Wolfsburg edition Jetta, which I didn't know about it.
Awesome, man.
Yeah. I learned stick in Volkswagen. It was a GTI. I was working at Toyota.
That's actually how I learned stick, too. Yeah. That Mark II. Because I bought it, and I didn't know how to drive it, and I wanted to drive it so bad.
For me, it was a Mark VI. For me, it was a Mark VI, so it was a little bit...
A little newer,
a little bit more rubbery. Supposedly, like, the best, like, stick out there is, like, a Civic.
Yeah.
But the GTI, I feel, is right up there as far as easiness.
Oh, yeah. It's
and
smooth.
Just throw.
Yeah,
did
it have one of those hill holder clutches on it, too? That was the one thing I hated about manual cars is, like, hills. If you had to stop on a hill... When I was in Italy, actually, we rented a Fiat for 2 weeks. That had a hill holder clutch. Let me tell you, that is the coolest thing since sliced bread.
I believe you.
Because, like, if you're at a stop...
Would you just hold it and just, like...
Yeah. Like, well, what happens is if you're at a stop and you're holding down the clutch...
Yeah.
And then you take your foot off the brake, it'll hold it there. It'll hold it, like, it'll keep the brakes applied until you release the clutch. So, like, it prevents that rollback.
Yeah. So you just hold the clutch and that's it until you let go and then put it on. Okay, no, that's cool. I've never seen that, but that's something I want to...
It's neat. Only specific models have it, but it was a nice feature. You know, that was my number one concern driving a manual car, because people would, like, if you'd stop on a hill and they don't know.
Then you look at a dumbass.
Yeah. And you end up stalling out or something.
But I went the Volkswagen tour, but the train was late.
Yeah.
Like, I had to get another train. Like, everybody had to get off the train and get back on another train. I think it was, like, due to construction or something like that.
Yeah.
And got back on the train, but when I got back on the train and actually landed in Wolfsburg, I was like 30 minutes late mm-hmm. for the English tour, so I had to take the German, like, spoken tour. Mm-hmm. And I still wanted to go. I was like, fuck yeah, I'll go. Like, I don't care if it's German or not. But you saw everything, but you saw the bodies. They made in the Wolfsburg factory, they had they're making Tiguans, GTIs, and
I like those Tiguans, man. Those things are gnarly.
Yeah, surprisingly. And then they got the new Atlas out. The Atlas is cool. And the new GLI mm-hmm. just recently came out. And now they're going to make
Dude, I love the concept for the new Scirocco they were going to come out with. But then, you know, it ended up coming out and looking nothing like the concept. But that's how most of those companies are.
But now their new concept, ever since, you know, because of Dieselgate, everything else.
You're talking about the new bus?
The new bus, yes.
What do you think about that?
I think that's a step in the right direction for Volkswagen.
Especially after that Dieselgate thing.
Correct. Yeah. It's going to get more people into electric drivetrains. And now they can, you know, they can make that more popular because of the shape of that bus. You know,
it's iconic.
It's iconic shaping. You can get away with that using an electric platform. You can't do that with an internal combustion engine in the front or in the back.
Yep.
And if you did, it would be kind of shoehorned in there.
Yeah, especially with
electric,
with
the battery, it's a flat floor.
Yeah. But, you know, especially with the way millennials are going, trying to live out of vans and shit.
Yeah, and or just maybe taking Uber everywhere.
Yeah, history repeats itself, man. I think we're going to have a resurgence of, the hippie generation. I mean, we kind of already are with all the nectarines out there and stuff with their patchouli and their fucking, what do you call them, the... pashminas and shit.
Yeah. that's going to come back. And now, we're going to see resurgences of that. Now, like, you can live in your van almost anywhere with, like, an internet connection, you know.
Yep.
And have everything kind of at your disposal inside of your van, you know, having, like, a little shower, a little cooking area, a living room, quote unquote, and a steering wheel. So that might become a thing again, but,
It's frustrating, like, with the price of living now. It's especially in the city, you know, and everyone's like, the way I view the city is, like, it's a rat race, man. Like, people will step on you if that means getting ahead in any way that they can. And like, that's one thing. Like, I love being here because there's just so much to do.
How
like,
long you been here for in Fishtown?
9 months. Okay. I've been here since August of last year. Mm-hmm. I plan on staying for a little while, you know, but I do miss the country. I miss the simplicity of it. I feel like there's just so much less
affecting clutter.
Yes, clutter. That's a good way to put it. You know, you don't have the anxiety and the frustration and the waiting that you have to deal with here. Like for me, like getting my ADHD prescription, I can't do that in the city. I remember one day I ended up going to 6 different pharmacies trying to get my prescription, and none of them had it. I have to go back to Reading if I want to get any kind of like prescription, especially like, you know, for like my Adderall, which is a narcotic. You know, you have to leave the city, you know, and like my girlfriend has uses the healthcare system here. And like she has to wait months before getting like an appointment somewhere.
Oh. Does weed help with that ADHD? Can you calm you down?
See, like I think it has to. It depends. It has to be a specific strain. I think. Okay. I think it needs to be. I want to say a sativa, but a lot of times I get stuck in my head with sativas. You know, I feel like I get paranoid. You know,
heard that.
But I think indicas actually help a little more, even though it's more of a body high. Mm-hmm. I think it helps me relax and focus a little better compared to like sativa, where I'm like, you know,
right.
Someone's outside my house. But you know, I don't know. I've experimented with a bunch of different ways of actually treating ADHD, and like I'm at this weird point in my life where I don't know if it's really as much of a crutch as I think it is. You know, I think I've blamed a lot of my inattentiveness and my problems on it, but I'm coming to the point in my life where I'm starting to study stoicism and being able to like take life with a grain of salt, realize that negative things are going to happen and acknowledge them, and then, you know, be able to move forward. Mm-hmm. And I think blaming my problems on things, whether it's people, whether it's medical problems, whatever, I need to move away from playing the blame game. You know, and start taking responsibility for my life, you know.
With that being said, it's like I thought about doing like edibles. I've gotten offered edibles and stuff like that before.
Oh, those things are crazy.
They are crazy, but it's like, how much do I take? Because like in the early days, it's like if you took a bite like this big, it would like it would put you out on your ass.
Oh yeah,
like for it's still like hours. That. It's evolved, at least from what I hear Joe Rogan.
The problem, I love that guy.
Shout out.
The problem, shout out
Joe Rogan.
He
doesn't need a shout out.
But I honestly think like it's not regulated, and that's the problem. So yes. Like I have friends that, you know, make brownies at home, but you don't know the true dosage that's in one of them.
Right.
You know? He's like, oh, just eat half, when really you should have eaten a quarter.
Right.
You know? Next thing you know, the walls are melting. Do you ever try shrooms or anything?
No, shroom. No, I'm only.
I don't like.
I only
them.
Drink and occasionally smoke.
I'm not a big fan of shrooms, but I love the sort of not stigma, like the information behind them. Like, do you ever hear about the stoned ape theory?
No.
Okay, so I heard about this on Joe Rogan. Is actually one of his guests, Paul Stemmitz, is like this guy that studies fungi for a living, and he's actually saying that. Fungi is actually like sentient, like it's alive, it can feel, you know, it's aware, and they actually make up these mycelial mats that cover like forests, so like it's all interconnected. Mm-hmm. It's like a brain, like a bunch of neurons connected. Yes. So like basically what he was saying is like the reason we got our sentience, or actually I should say sapience, because there's a difference between sentience and sapience. Sentience is where you can feel, you have emotions and whatnot, where sapience is like complex thought. So like when people say, oh, animals are sentient, it's like, okay, they feel fear and like happiness, but they don't ask questions. They aren't aware of the world that they're not, like say for example, primates, you can teach them how to speak sign language.
Right.
Not once in history have they ever asked a question. They don't ask, why am I here? What am I doing here? What is my purpose in the world? So like basically, sorry, I'll get back to this theory.
That's fine.
Basically they're saying that early man was actually, you know, hunters and gatherers, you know, and they would track these animals, and you know, they'd find dung and whatnot tracking them, and they would find these mushrooms. And they, you know, it's been proven that psilocybin specifically has a way of reconnecting neurons in the brain or creating new pathways in the brain. So basically what they're saying is the reason we became sentient is because we were experimenting with hallucinogenics as early man. So like the reason we became self-aware, the reason we became sapient is because of hallucinogenics. Because like even now, like they're studying psilocybin and how it can help people with post-traumatic stress, depression. And the number one problem with those kinds of like issues, like depression, like you have like disconnects in the brain.
Yeah, it's almost like our neurons or yes. nerves are not
they're not
really
connecting,
like,
and connecting, they're not firing yes. properly. Yeah. So like what they're saying is with psilocybin, you can reconnect those parts of the brain and literally cure it. You know, like that's, and you look at, I think there's a lot of interesting information coming out about like some stuff that's labeled as a narcotic, like MDMA can treat post-traumatic stress, you know, psilocybin can treat depression. You know, I think we need to move further into exploring that kind of stuff, which is why I love people like Joe Rogan.
The thing that's holding me back into doing mushrooms and or anything else, it's kind of like, what if I have that bad trip? Because I feel, or at least from what I've heard from other people, it's like with mushrooms and or like kind of like with acid, it's like, it can go to either extreme, like,
well, it's the fear. It's the fear of getting into that is what, like you shouldn't go into it with fear. Like I've yet to do DMT because I've heard people tell me, don't go into it afraid of the bad trip. You need to do it when you're open-minded, when you're relaxed, and you need to be willing to accept and enjoy and explore the experience that you're having versus like, you know, like you should do that doing any kind of hallucinogenic or psychedelic, you know,
be relaxed.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, shrooms is a little different. Shrooms is more of like a hallucinogenic. Psilocybin, what you're actually doing is you're like poisoning yourself. Just like say like peyote or ayahuasca or any of them, you're actually sort of poisoning yourself. Mm-hmm. And then your body cleaning that toxin out is why you trip, where like acid's a little different. Acid, LSDs, I think it's fascinating, but it's a psychedelic, not a hallucinogenic. Mm. So like you see things in a weird, like it kills your ego more or less, you know. So like if you were to like take LSD and then try to go DJ, you couldn't do it.
Okay.
Like I've tried to do it before, and it doesn't, like you just shy away from that kind of stuff. It makes you humble. It makes you look at the universe in a different way. And like the best place to do that would be at a music festival. Or a camping festival where you're surrounded by people you care about. You're surrounded by interesting people that care about you, you know? And like anytime I've ever gone down that wrong path, that scary path, there's always been people there to help me, you know, and work me out of it. And the one thing you have to remember is it never lasts forever. So like, it's fun to experiment. And even if it does get bad, it'll go away. The number one thing that people are, that the reason they freak out is because they think it's not going to stop, you know? And unless you, like SLC Punk, where that guy like had like two sheets of acid in his pocket and he ran through sprinklers and perma-tripped for the rest of his life, that usually doesn't happen. No.
And I guess that's why people do acid in kind of like, I guess, in mostly kind of like populated areas where there just happens to be like a concert going on. Because that's what like, and it's like, that's how it debuted in the fucking 60s.
Yeah,
you know,
Bicycle Day.
Yeah,
you know all about that. 419.
419. No,
not 420.
Not 420. No, even though I am very much into cycling, I'm not sure if it involves cycling.
Okay, so
419.
So the story about this is the guy.
I guess it doesn't get as much love as 420 because 420 is more like.
Yeah,
oh, you know about
everyone
it.
Knows about
like,
that.
Like,
but no one knows about 419.
But then again, every day is a holiday these days, according to Facebook.
Yeah.
Oh, this is International Ice Cream Day. Sure. Okay. Nice.
But 419 is what's called Bicycle Day. And that's when the father of LSD took the first trip.
Oh, took his first bike ride and like discovered LS.
Well,
correct? Kind of in that same thing?
Well, before Bicycle Day, he had actually accidentally gotten some of it on his skin, and he felt noticed that his skin like absorbed it, you know? So like the following day, he decided to intentionally ingest a specific amount. Now, the amount of micrograms he did is like insane. Like you should never do that amount, but apparently he like did this. he was feeling a little bit weird, and then, you know, he rode his bike home from work, and that's why we celebrate Bicycle Day, the world's first, you know, psychedelic trip. But, you know, I just find it fascinating most people don't know about that. And it's the day before 420, so of course it's overshadowed by it, mm-hmm. you know?
Okay, so I'm on Urban Dictionary right now. Bicycle Day. Bicycle is on April 19th, of course. 1943, when Dr. Albert Hofmann first took LSD intentionally. 3 days later, he absorbed a small amount of the drug by either through his fingertips or accidentally adjusting it. On Bicycle Day, he took 250
micrograms.
Micrograms. It says UG, but
yeah, that's micrograms.
Micrograms.
Yeah.
Okay. LSD intentionally, and fearing he had made himself ill, cycled from his lab during his bicycle ride and experienced the effects of LSD, making it the day of the first acid trip.
Yep.
It's wild.
Learning something new every day.
You're learning
day,
something
right?
new every day. Let's see where we're at. We're at like an hour 40. So this is officially the longest podcast, which congratulations.
Awesome.
I like to do this shit. I guess we're going to,
we could talk forever, man.
Yeah, we could talk forever. Going to go rapid fire here. So at one point you had blonde hair.
Yeah, I actually kind of want to go back to that. I miss that. It was different, you know. I'm just like a little afraid of that because if I do get another job somewhere,
right.
I might look unprofessional. But, you know.
How old are you now?
I just turned 26 on June 10th.
Congrats. I'm 28 now, and I'm going to be 29 in September. So okay. I guess that's kind of right around the corner.
Not 30 yet.
Not quite, bitch. who are you listening to now?
Oh, dude, you can't ask me that question.
Too many?
It's so hard. Like when people, I'm like, oh, there's so many artists that I love. And they're like, pick three that are your favorite. And like, you can't ask
it's
me kinda,
that. Yeah.
Like,
it's hard.
Yeah, because like what I feel is my favorite today might not be my favorite tomorrow.
Okay.
You know, I'll discover a new artist or something like that. You know, but like I'm a big fan of this artist named Posij, P-O-S-I-J. He's a cool guy. He just came out with, I love him because he does a lot of different stuff. Like his newer stuff is a little more experimental, like half step drum and bass. But then he did drum and bass. He did house. Like he does all kinds of stuff. I'm a huge fan of Spore too. The guy that's
Spore, yeah.
Or Feed Me, you know. I'm trying to think. I love Drum Sound, Bassline Smith. Chase and Status just came out with their Return to Jungle album. That is incredible. The song Program by Chase and Status. Check that out. That's amazing track.
Yes, well, I'm going to buy some drum bass tracks more on Beatport now because of this podcast. For
yeah,
sure.
Come over, bring your flash drive sometime, man. I got CDJs.
Okay, cool. Actually, no. Like I'm right here.
You want to play some music then? It'll take me 5 minutes to set it up.
This is going to be your next time. I gotta work all right. early, but all
right.
I'll take you up on the offer for sure. Okay. I guess that any promotions, any events you got lined up, any shout outs?
We don't have anything coming up currently. We're aiming for something in August, but with Cody starting his new business and Emily starting a new job. I have a new roommate moving in soon. That's sort of like the forefront of like what we're doing. I'm going to Hydrotechnics at the end of the month. So there's a lot of stuff going on right now, but we are definitely not going anywhere. I think, once winter comes around, it's going to be like clockwork because like as soon as that college season starts up again, we're going back to Sprout. I want to get there as often as possible because like that college crowd, they show up in force.
Agreed.
And Sprout is open till 3 a.m. It's like the latest open bar in Westchester. And it's a great opportunity for the bar to make money and for us to make money.
Yep. And you come out gay. Well, you come in gay, you come in high. You come in high, and then you come out gay. Whoever the running joke is, because there's two streets called High Street and Gay Street,
yeah.
And like they intersect each other. It's like there's this running joke in Westchester about it. It's like it's like you come in gay, and then you come out high, whatever, and vice versa. But if you've never been down to Westchester, it's a cool little spot. Again, college crowd is always there, so they always come in for force, almost like University of Delaware, where there's Main Street,
yep.
You know, Klondike Cakes and Deer Park and everything else. And
it's a
cool,
it's a really awesome venue, man.
Diverse,
I like how
yeah.
small it is.
Yeah, I like it. I'm going to go back there soon. I think somebody else is having an event there quite soon. I
don't know. Dude, DJ Ha, the guy that does Rainforest. He had Rainforest there once. I think he does it there every once in a while. I know he does the Barbary sometimes.
Yep.
But I know he does it at Sprout pretty often. So, I mean, he's a cool guy. I want to get more involved with him, especially with drum and bass. So.
Gotcha. Well, I'll tell you what, you have your foot two steps ahead in front of everybody else as far as the drum bass scene is concerned.
I know. I'm happy about that. I am.
pleasure. Keep being who you are. I'm going to keep listening. And I think everybody here should listen to you just as well. If you have a SoundCloud or Mixcloud, plug that. Check this guy on Facebook. I'll put his description. I'll put his links up to his Facebook or whatever in the description below. Anyway, Taylor, thank you so much. I think the rain has stopped. So just in time. So I'm going to put my stuff away. And thank you for the coffee just as well.
Yeah, of course, man.
Ladies and gentlemen, Marble, Taylor, thank you so much, buddy.
Yeah, of course, man. Appreciate it. Thank you.
And we are going to tune out this shit. Just kind of like this.
Retreat, we're going to turn you over. Retreat, turn wide, surrender.